So what I'm going to present are a few things which have already been talked about. How does the government make decisions about introducing vaccines? Or put another way, how should it make decisions? And I'm a member of the National Immunization Technical Advisory Group. We also have our secretary there, if you can raise your hand, Syria. But Charlotte Wasbon is actually our health economist, and the chair is Professor Swankango. And this is the outline. And just to say that we have something called the NITAG, and these are cross countries. The NITAG, these are teams of experts that are appointed by government to advise it on all issues related to immunization. So in this question you've been asking, should we introduce vaccines or not? This is an issue that we deal with, or the issue of fake vaccines and stuff like that. And we are experts from medicine, microbiology, vaccinology, pediatrics, public health, health economics, health systems, sociology, etc. And when we need that, when we find we don't have an expert, we look for that expert to co-opt to join us. So the government of Uganda actually formed the NITAG back in 2014. The minister appointed us as members of the NITAG, the Minister of Health, to advise him. Currently, actually, we are waiting for renewal of that contract. Members of the NITAG actually not paid, and they are meant to be independent. They are not actually meant to be paid at all, except transport to fund. That's fine. So the government asked us a question that we are stuck with this thing that Shad was talking about. So they said we are going to pause new vaccine introduction because we are mixed, we don't have the co-financing, the program is not performing, and said, advise us, which of the three vaccines should we introduce and in what order of priority? So this is a question that can come to you. And it took us 8 months of sitting so many times in multiple committees to give the government a report. So the Minister of Health at that time suspended the new vaccine introduction for a year, waiting for this advice, and we were actually under pressure. So we came up with a methodology, and perhaps this is the most important slide I'm going to present. How did we decide? So we came up with a prioritization framework, and which the first thing is you set the purpose and objective of what you are trying to decide. Just like having a research question. Then you come up with prioritization criteria, which you say basically is the methodology. And then how you score, part of the methodology still. And then the weighting and the ranking of this. So this is the prioritization criteria that we used. And the vaccines that the government asked us, they said we have these in our plans, and we have the pressure from government that we introduce them. Then this same government puts pressure on government to introduce vaccines. So it's sometimes even the way this co-sharing. So one of them was the measles second dose. This measles second dose, remember we have one dose of measles. So the government was asking, should we introduce a measles second dose? And should this measles dose contain rubella? You know, for those of you who are medics, you know, a congenital rubella syndrome. So the second one was, should we switch from TT, tetanus toxoid, to tetanus diphtheria? There is a global trend where the tetanus TT is going to stop to be produced. So naturally, we are going to go to the next if we have a problem, which is TD. And then the third one, should we introduce hepatitis B mass dose, which was the most tricky. You know, we have this problem of hepatitis B in the country. So the question was, should we introduce a vaccine at birth to protect newborns? And then should we introduce ear fever? There's also issues of ear fever. And should we introduce meningitis A? These were the vaccines, and the government had money for most of them. So we went to vaccine by vaccine, And we started with the first thing, which was setting the purpose of an objective. So I alluded to this, which research questions we were trying to answer. And then we identified the prioritization criteria. And maybe after the other things, it was again the most important thing. So we had that criteria, but the things we looked at, one, we looked at the disease. So you know, for this disease, let's say hepatitis B, do we have the burden of disease? Is it a major problem? Or hepatitis fever, is it a major problem? You go and look for literature in Uganda, confirming whether we have that burden. Then, the second one, do we have a vaccine that is safe and can be used in our setting? So we, for hepatitis B, for instance, we go and look at the available vaccines and whether they are safe, what is the literature behind the vaccine, how do they decide even, what studies are being done, what trials were done. So you need a lot of data. And you would ask the question, have we ever done a hepatitis B study in Uganda? Vaccine trial, for instance. The third one is we look at the economic considerations, the issues Charlotte was presenting. What is the cost of the vaccine? Is it cost effective? We actually looked at cost effectiveness. And how much do we need if to add it to introduce, but also sustain it? We had to do all that work, and that is why we worked with Charlotte and others. Then we looked at the health system and policy problematic issues. Is it in our policy? This vaccine, like the Mount Country Young Plan, and can the health system afford it? How is the vaccine? How is it packed? Can the cold chain be able to maintain and also be able to transport this vaccine? Do we have vaccine stores? In which form should this vaccine come? So those are some of the issues that we looked at, and of course we do a ranking. So we did a lot of literature, and I must say we got help because imagine I'm busy enough, Charlotte is busy, Professor Swarkar is busy. So we had some actual students from the US who were here as interns helping us to do literature review. But in future we could use students like you people. We are looking for people. So that we do systematic review, we look for as much literature as possible, that in the process that is replicable. We used PubMed, Embeds, we looked at Scopus, Cochrane reviews, we looked at peer literature, we appraised the literature using appraisal criteria, which is called appraisal skill program. And also, we looked at other background literature available in the Ministry of Health and its partners. Then we did this in working groups. So there was a working group almost on each of these vaccines. Some working groups worked on more than two vaccines because we are a small team of members. And then once we had all this information and summarized it, combining disease burden, vaccine issues, economic issues, systems issues, and other, we came up with a process for assessing and scoring the evidence and weighing so that we make a decision. So we adopted several tools. We adopted a tool from an organization called CIVAC. CIVAC is an international organization which actually supports countries in the decision making, especially around our vaccines. But also we are helped by the Health Policy and Development Center, which is an institute in the West. But also we had a tool that we adopted from the Institute of Medicine, which is in the US, accredited to NIH. So in other words, what I'm trying to say, it was based on evidence and a process. So what were the findings? These findings are the basis for what Dr. Wise presented. We looked at measles. We say that your measles is a problem. User had outbreaks. We're also getting outbreaks of rubella. And there is evidence for that, that we have this problem. And so based on all that criteria we went through, we recommended that the government would consider introducing the measles rubella vaccine. So the decision the government now is making is based on the recommendation that NITAG made, that we should now introduce a second measles dose, but also measles which is combined with rubella, not measles alone, which is going to be a future strategy. They have already applied for this. I'm not going to go into the details of this, but also we are advised on how many doses, when should it be given, based on the literature. They also recommended that they introduce a second dose of measles rubella vaccine. So the country will no longer be just getting one jab, but two measles doses, which will improve the control of measles. Then we went to tetanus. Again, we went through the same criteria for tetanus, and there is evidence that tetanus is a problem. We have regular outbreaks. Safe medical circumcision is one of the issues, and especially among women 5 years and above. Despite getting TT, we are getting so many women getting tetanus, and we don't know why. And the TD, which is an alternative, is actually a cheap vaccine, almost the cost of the current TT. So in terms of economics, it was not a big thing. The government is already buying TT. It could, if TT is no longer the vaccine, and it is TD, the vaccine the government could afford. And because of that, we say it's not actually going to change so much issues of cost. And we recommended that the government introduce switches from TT to TD. So I'm sure Dr. Luza is going to be coming with a recommendation based on that. But also, we recommended Uganda to add 3 booster doses of TB if they can afford it. Now, afford is a problem, because we recommended to give TB at 12 to 23 months. That is basically the second year, which, and Dr. Luzia already said, that the program stops at 1 year. So if they go second year, there are going to be more children, more problems. Can they do it? These are again things they have to think about. But also another dose at 5 years. This is based on the literature that in order to protect the entire population, you need actually doses at birth, then this one in second year, the fifth year, and the booster dose at 9 to 15 years. There will have long time protection, and then women will no longer need to get TT because they would have been protected when they are young. That is really rationale. Then meningitis, you know that, especially in most of Uganda, we get it is in the meningitis disease zone, belt, they call it, with sometimes outbreaks, and these outbreaks, when they occur, they're actually very bad for people who get a disease. They either die, or sometimes they get permanent spread. But the good thing is not really good, but the disease is limited in a certain area from the epidemiology that we have. But one of the things we found that the last case of meningitis A was actually in 2009. And the government has been doing this mass preventive campaigns. So it seems the campaigns actually have been good. They prevent epidemics so that if they are to occur, they will come after 10 years. So based on those considerations and other literature, we said although we could introduce meningitis A, for now it could be limited to the region where the outbreaks are common. And if fiscal space, that is if we have the resources available, then they could consider adding it in the entire program for the entire country, but only if there is fiscal space. Then we looked at yellow fever, which is really a very fatal disease, and recently Uganda has been having some outbreaks. But actually the numbers are not so much. And WHO has done a couple of assessments, what they call the WHO risk assessment for yellow fever outbreak. And they find that we are fairly safe. Those of you who have been following the news there was a very big outbreak in Angola and also in Brazil. And Uganda also had an outbreak, but Uganda, as always, was able to control the outbreak as opposed to Angola and Brazil. So Uganda, her system, if it is supported, actually it can perform. The challenge is support. So this one, but the challenge is that the yellow fever vaccine is actually expensive, and globally the supplies are low. So introducing it in the population, we might introduce, and later they tell you that the vaccine ran out, the factories are no longer able to produce it, which was taken to Brazil or Angola. So based on all those considerations, we said if UNITA recommends the introduction of the vaccine in Uganda's routine immunization schedule at 12 months of age, but actually we are going to see some other considerations that we looked at. Then we looked at hepatitis B first dose, an epidemic which is now becoming bigger than I think HIV, professor might say, and big risk of outbreaks, and quite fatal, we don't have good treatment. But most importantly, actually, children in Uganda get hepatitis B immunization when they get the pentavirus, 3 doses. So children from 6 months on, 6, 10, and 14, receive this vaccine. And we looked for literature. We learned that at the time, the Ministry of Health and Preparedness had just done the National Cell Survey, and one of the things they looked at was hepatitis B. And they found that among this cohort of children who have been getting the pentavalent, among those children, since we introduced this new vaccine, I think around 2000, the cell prevalence of hepatitis B was so low, was actually at 0.6. So actually, this vaccine among those children is working to prevent outbreak among those who got the pentavalent. And the literature showed us that even if we introduced it at birth, we may not improve this figure much. There's no evidence to show that when we give it at birth, which is also a challenge, because where do you find the people? How do you find people at birth? Does they find at home? And actually, regions which are at highest risk are where people most have delivered at home. So, but also the evidence WHO used to recommend a vaccine, we found that evidence was weak. The studies that are very few and weak. So we recommended right now, based on available evidence, we don't recommend introduction of hepatitis B birth dose. In other words, to continue with the pentavalent would help in the population. So those were, I'm not going to repeat this, we ended up by recommending to adopt TD and then switch from measles to measles rubella and introduce a second measles dose as the top priority. So there are the two vaccines that we recommended as top priority. As we say, recommended. We ranked and said the top vaccine is TD. The second one is measles rubella. But if Dr. Wilson went with measles rubella, yet number one was TD. So maybe he will be telling us why. And then the introduction of meningitis A containing vaccine in the target districts could be done, but should be considered secondary and based on fiscal space if there is money we can address problematic issues. We also had some general recommendations. So to summarize at this stage, 5 vaccines, 4 of them we said if the government can afford, they can introduce, but one of them, we don't have enough evidence. But the top two, we are TB and measles rubella. But we made some recommendation that program effectiveness should be the first priority. So before you introduce these vaccines, improve the program. The second recommendation was that we need greater investment in multidisciplinary research, because in order for us to advise government, we need evidence, but there are few people doing immunization research. I expect this room to be full, but actually it's not. So we need that more advocacy to get people to come and be interested in immunization research. I think those are our major recommendations, and that is how governments so far these days making decisions around new vaccine introduction.
Thank you very much.